ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमम् देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासम् ततो जयमुदीरये। नष्टप्रायेषु अभद्रेषु नित्यं भागवत सेवया भगवती उत्तम श्लोके भक्तिर्भवति निष्ठिके। मूकङ्गरतिवाचालं पुङ्गलङ्गयते गिरिं यत्रपातमहं वन्दे श्रीगुरुं दीनतारणं श्रीपरमानन्दमाधवम्। So today we are reading from Bhagavad Gita, chapter 14, text 16. The three modes of material nature: karmanah, sukrutasyahu, सात्विकं निर्मलं फलं रजसा तु फलं दुःखं अज्ञानं तमसः फलं कर्मणा सुकृतस्याः सात्विकं निर्मलं फलं रजसस्तु फलं दुःखं अज्ञानं तमसा फलं कर्मणा सुकृतस्याः सात्विकं निर्मलं फलं रजसस्तु फलं दुःखं अज्ञानं तमसा फलं कर्मणा सुकृतस्याः सात्विकं निर्मलं फलं रजसस्तु फलं दुःखं अज्ञानं तमसा फलम्। कर्मणा सुकृतस्याः सात्विकं निर्मलं फलं रजसस्तु फलं दुःखं अज्ञानं तमसा फलम्। कर्मणा सुकृतस्याः सात्विकं निर्मलं फलं रजसस्तु फलं दुःखं अज्ञानं तमसः फलम्। कर्मणा सुकृतस्याः कर्मणा सुकृतः सात्विकं निर्मलं फलं रजसस्तु फलं दुःखं अज्ञानं तमसः फलं। माताजी कर्मणा सुकृतः सात्विकं निर्मलं फलं रजसस्तु फलं दुःखं अज्ञानं तमसः फलं। कर्मणः ऑफ वर्क सुकृतस्य पायस आहु इज सेड सात्विकम इन द मोड ऑफ गुडनेस निर्मलम प्यूरिफाइड फलम द रिजल्ट रजस of the mode of passion to but phalam the result dukkham misery agyanam nonsense tamasah of the mode of ignorance phalam the result Translation and purport by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Translation. The result of pious action is pure and is said to be in the mode of goodness. But action done in the mode of passion results in misery, and action performed in the mode of ignorance results in foolishness. Purport. The result of pious activities in the mode of goodness is pure. Therefore, the sages who are free from all illusion are situated in happiness. But activities in the mode of passion are simply miserable. Any activity for material happiness is bound to be defeated. If, for example, one wants to have a skyscraper, so much human misery has to be undergone before a big skyscraper can be built. The financier has to take much trouble to earn a mass of wealth. And those who are slaving to construct the building have to render physical toil. The miseries are there. Thus, Bhagavad Gita says that in any activity performed under the spell of the mode of passion, there is definitely great misery. There may be a little so-called material happiness. I have this house or this money. But this is not actual happiness. As far as the mode of ignorance is concerned, the performer is without knowledge. And therefore, all his activities result in present misery, and afterwards he will go on towards animal life. Animal life is always miserable. Although, under the spell of illusory energy, Maya, the animals do not understand this. Slaughtering poor animals is also due to the mode of ignorance. The animal killers do not know that in the future, the animal will have a body suitable to kill them. That is the law of nature. In human society, if one kills a man, he has to be hanged. That is the law of the state. Because of ignorance, people do not perceive that there is a complete state controlled by the Supreme Lord. Every living creature is a son of the Supreme Lord, and he does not tolerate even an ant's being killed. One has to pay for it. So indulgence in animal killing for the taste of the tongue is the grossest kind of ignorance. A human being has no need to kill animals because God has supplied so many nice things. If one indulges in meat eating anyway, it is to be understood that he is acting in ignorance and is making his future very dark. Of all kinds of animal killing, the killing of cows is most vicious because the cow gives us all kinds of pleasure by supplying milk. Cow slaughter is an act of the grossest type of ignorance. In the Vedic literature, Rig Veda 9.46.4, the words govi prinita matsaram indicate that one who being fully satisfied by milk is desirous of killing the cow is in the grossest ignorance. There is also a prayer in the Vedic literature that states, Namo Brahman Devaya Go Brahmana Hitaya Cha Jagaddhitaya Krishnaya Govindaya Namo Namo. My Lord, you are the well-wisher of the cows and the Brahmanas, and you are the well-wisher of the entire human society and world. Vishnu Purana 1965. The purpose is that special mention is given in that prayer for the protection of the cows and the Brahmanas. Brahmanas are the symbol of spiritual education, and cows are the symbol of most valuable food. These two living creatures, the Brahmanas and the cows, must be given all protection. That is the real advancement of civilization. In modern human society, spiritual knowledge is neglected and cow killing is encouraged. It is to be understood then that human society is advancing in the wrong direction and is clearing the path to its own condemnation. A civilization which guides the citizens to become animals in their next lives is certainly not a human civilization. The present human civilization is, of course, grossly misled by the modes of passion and ignorance. It is a very dangerous age, and all nations should take care to provide the easiest process, Krishna consciousness, to save humanity from the greatest danger.
ज्ञानतिमिरन्धस्य ज्ञानञ्जनशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः. श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपकदामयं ददाति स्वपदन्तिकम्. वन्देऽं श्रीगुरो श्रीयुतपदकमलं श्रीगुरुन् वैष्णवंश श्रीरूपं शक्रजातं सगणरघुनाथ नितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनसहितं कृष्णं चैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधाकृष्णपादान् सगणललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितंश्च. हे कृष्ण करुणा सिंधु दीनबंधो जगत्पति गोपेश गोपिका कंत राधा कंत नमस्ते. तप्त कंचन गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी विश्वानुसृते देवी प्रणमामि हरिप्रिये पंचाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्यश्च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः नमो महावदान्याय कृष्ण प्रेम प्रदायते कृष्णाय कृष्ण चैतन्य नमने गौरतिसे नमः जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर शिवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे
कर्मण सुकृत साहु सात्विकं निर्मलं फलं रजसस्तु फलं दुःखं अज्ञानं तमसः फलं। सो हियर इन दिस वर्स ऑफ भगवद गीता लॉर्ड कृष्ण व्हाइल इंस्ट्रक्टिंग अर्जुना इज स्पीकिंग अबाउट द थ्री मोड्स ऑफ मेटेरियल नेचर and the result of acting in these three modes. So here in this verse, Lord Krishna says, karmana sukrutasya ahu. So when one will perform pious activity. Sukruta means pious activity. Sukruti, Ajnata Sukruti we say. So when we perform pious activity, then what is the result of performing pious activity? Pious activity means whatever has been instructed in the scriptures we perform accordingly. And the result of karmana is sattvika. So this pious activity is called, is performed in the mode of goodness. So the person who is in the mode of goodness, he would like to perform these pious activities. That is the symptom. That person in the mode of goodness, he is attached to perform pious activities. Because these three modes of material nature are there in the living entities. And there is action and reaction going on between these three modes. Sometimes the mode of goodness become prominent, sometimes the mode of passion becomes prominent, and sometimes the mode of ignorance becomes prominent. And accordingly, one performs activity. So when the mode of goodness is prominent in someone, that does not mean that he is free from passion and ignorance. There may be little passion and ignorance may be there. But the main mode is goodness. That's why generally we see those who are in the mode of goodness, they are attached to knowledge. They want to get knowledge. So, because they want to get knowledge, then they accordingly act also, according to the knowledge. Because when we act without any knowledge, then we may perform so many sinful activities. That is, those who are in the mode of goodness, they are in knowledge because they know the scriptural injunctions. That's why when they perform activity, that is sukruti, means pious activity they perform. They follow the scriptural injunctions. That's why the result is very pure. When someone performs activity in mode of goodness, the result is very pure. Nirmalam. It says sattvikam nirmalam phalam. Nirmal means pure. So, this when the result is very pure, then that is called sattvika, mode of goodness. And then when one performs activity in the mode of goodness, so the result is pure and the result is also sukha, means happiness. So that means anyone who performs activity in the mode of goodness, that activity will be pure itself and that will give happiness to the performer. That's why we see it has been stated that those who leave their body in the mode of goodness, they are promoted urdham gacchanti sattvastha. They are promoted to the higher planetary systems, such as janaloka, tapaloka, brahmaloka, so they can attain. And to attain that, those planets means sukha, happiness is there. These material miseries are not there in higher planets. Though birth and death is there everywhere, but these material miseries are not there. So, those who are in the mode of goodness, they get this resultant reaction, fruits, that is happiness. And then Krishna says, rajastastu phalam dukkham. And those who are in the mode of passion, so those who are passionate, they have so many different desires, so many material desires to fulfill, and they are very greedy to get the result and enjoy. This is the nature of the people who are in the mode of passion. And that's why, just to become happy, they work very hard. Even sometimes day and night. They don't have time to take proper rest, or they don't have time to take, even eat their foodstuff properly. They don't have time. They work so hard. And then, in this way, they become attachment. Attachment to their work, attachment to the result of the work. Because they want to get the result and enjoy. That's why they have too much attachment. So in this way, the result of working in this way, in the mode of passion, is phalam dukkham. At the end, actually one, instead of getting happiness, one ends up in misery. This is the result of working in the mode of passion. Srila Prabhupada gives very nice example in the purport. So Prabhupada says that those who are in the mode of passion, they want to do something, create something for their happiness. So he gives the example of making a skyscraper building. So to make a skyscraper building, or even just a simple building, or to speak of skyscraper, that is a big thing. Just to build a simple building, one has to first get money. Unless one arranges money, he cannot build something. That's why he has to also work hard to get money. And when he gets money or arranges money from somewhere, or takes a loan, whatever, and then he builds the building. And to build a building, also he has to arrange so many ingredients, he has to arrange proper workers, and he has to supervise the work. Unless one supervises the work, work will not be done properly. So in this way, he actually works very hard just to have a building. So while building the building, he is suffering. He is working very hard. And then after the building is ready, then he may try to stay in that building, and he may feel very satisfied that, okay, this is my building. This is his happiness, that this is mine. I build this building. People feel very proud that I have this building, I have this, I have that. They feel very proud. So, but this is their only happiness in mind. And then what happens? Then the building wants maintenance. This thing broke, that thing broke, this thing happened, that thing happened. Then this is a lifetime thing goes on with that. So where is actually real happiness? That's why Prabhupada says the happiness is only in the mind. That, I have this building, or I have built this building. So in the same way, we see all types of material happiness. Whatever we see in this material world, if we think about that happiness, what is that? Actually, there is no real happiness. The happiness is only in mind. We suffer actually. We suffer in so many ways. Our body suffers, we suffer in so many. Mentally we suffer, physically we suffer, just to get happiness, and that happiness happens only in mind. That, I enjoy it, or I have this, I have that, only in mind. So actually there is no real happiness to work in the mode of passion. This is an illusory happiness. But people, they are so attached to that, so they are so greedy for that, they cannot give up for this illusory happiness. And they have no time to think for God because of this, because they are very busy. They will say, Swamiji, I have no time, I am very busy. Busy for what? So this is going on. There is a nice story about this actually. How people, they become so greedy. And they are so much attached to this material wealth, material happiness. Once there was a king, and the king was very pious king. In those days, the kings were Rajarshis, they were very pious, and they were knowledgeable, and they are also devotees of the Lord, and they are ruling the kingdom according to the religious principles, according to the scriptural injunctions. So that king, he himself was worshipping the Supreme Lord, and he was ruling his subjects and trying to make them Krishna conscious, because he was ruling his subjects according to scriptural injunctions. So then one day, because he was worshipping the Supreme Lord, so the Supreme Lord was very much pleased with his worship. Then the Supreme Lord actually appeared in front of him. And then the king was very happy to see the Supreme Lord, his worshipable Lord. He paid his obeisances, and he was so overwhelmed with happiness, tears were flowing from his eyes, and he was offering prayers to the Supreme Lord. And then the Supreme Lord told the king that, okay, I am very much pleased with your worship, so I want to fulfill your desires. So please tell me what you want from me. I want to give you a boon to fulfill your desire. So the king said, because the king was very much looking for the happiness of his subjects, that how they can become Krishna conscious, how they can come to the lotus feet of the Lord. So he did not ask anything for himself, because he was a king, he has everything. So he asked the Supreme Lord that, my dear Lord, if you are really pleased with me, then you can give me this boon, that as you have manifested yourself in front of me, so I want that you should also manifest in front of all the subjects of my kingdom. So they will be blessed when they will get darshan of you. They will be blessed and their life will be successful. Then the Lord said, how is it possible? This cannot be possible. That everyone, I cannot give darshan to everyone. Because the Lord says, Nahum Prakasa Sarvasa Yogamaya Samabhruta. I am not manifested to everyone, and especially the foolish people. So I am covered by my Yogamaya potency. But here the devotee is requesting the Lord to give darshan to all his subjects, all his citizens. The Lord said, this is not possible. I cannot give darshan to everyone. Then the king requested the Lord that, my dear Lord, if you will not give darshan yourself, then how my subjects will be delivered from this cycle of birth and death? Because I am a well-wisher of my subjects. That's why I am requesting you, please be merciful. If you are really merciful on me, so please be merciful to grant my desire and be merciful to my subjects. So when the devotee insisted, the Lord then said, okay, I will give darshan to your subjects, citizens. So you come to a place, come to a mountain, where there is a mountain nearby. You come to that mountain, so I will manifest myself on the top of that mountain, so everyone can get darshan. All the citizens can get darshan. Then the king was very much pleased. Said, oh, very nice. The Lord agreed at last. So now my citizens will be delivered by getting darshan of the Lord. So then the king, being very happy, so he made the announcement throughout the kingdom that the Lord has agreed to give darshan. So tomorrow we all will go to that mountain where the Lord will appear, and we can all get darshan of the Lord, and our life will be delivered. So our life will be successful. So then all the citizens, they started going with the king, and king with his queen and his family members, his associates, everyone accompanied the king, including the subjects. So they are all going to get darshan of the Lord. Then on the way, suddenly they saw a mountain. The mountain is made of not gold, tamba, copper mountain. And there are so many copper coins in that mountain. So some of you know the story maybe. So then some citizens, those who are going with the king, they could not resist themselves. So there were so many copper coins in the mountain. The mountain is full of copper coins. So let us go and get as much as possible some copper coins, then our life will be successful. We can enjoy our life. Then they started going towards that copper mountain to collect copper coins. So when the king saw that some of his subjects are going towards the copper mountain, then he forbade them, what are you doing? We are going to see the Supreme Lord. And you are going to that copper mountain to collect copper coins? What you will do with copper coins? If you get darshan of the Lord, your life will be successful. But those people, they did not listen to the king. They were so greedy for the copper coins, anyway they went. And they collected as much as they can, put a big cloth, put everything, all the copper coins. Everyone did the same thing. They collected of their own, as much as they can carry. And after collecting the copper coins, they straight went home. And they did not go with the king. And then the king went ahead with the other citizens. And then after some distance, they found another mountain made of silver. And there are so many silver coins in that mountain, full of silver coins. And then when they were passing by, some citizens, those who are going with the king, some of them, they have become very attracted towards the silver coins. He said, we gave up copper coins, but now we got silver coins. So let us go collect silver coins. So they all went not all, some of them. Some of them went to collect silver coins, and they could collect as much as they could, and then they went back home. Then the rest of the citizen with the king, they went ahead to get the darshan of the Lord. And then after some distance, they saw another mountain, Gold Mountain. And then there are so many gold coins in that mountain. So the other citizens, those who are with the king, they could not resist themselves. There's so many gold coins, who can give up gold coins? So they went to collect gold coins. The king was telling, hey, what are you all doing? We are going to see the Lord. And your life will be successful, but you are going to collect these gold coins? But the citizens did not listen to the king. They went anyway and collected gold coins as much as they could, and they went back home. So now the king saw that everyone went to collect gold coins and only queen is left with the king. No citizens were there. No citizens, his associates, others, no one was there. Everyone went to collect gold coins and went back home. So the king told the queen, you see, the Lord promised to give darshan, and we are going to get darshan of the Lord, and when we get darshan of the Lord, our life would have been successful. But these foolish citizens, for them I requested to the Lord. Lord was not agreeing to give darshan. For them I requested to the Lord to give darshan, and the Lord agreed at last with great endeavor. And I was, you see, these foolish citizens, they became attracted with all these copper, silver and gold coins, and they all went back home. No one is with us to get darshan of the Lord. So the queen said, these people are very unfortunate. What to do? Let us both go and get darshan of the Lord. So they went ahead. Then after some distance, the king and queen, they saw a diamond mountain. And there are so many diamonds were there, and very attractive diamonds. And the diamonds are of different colors, glazing. Like all different seven colors, glazing in the mountain. And the queen could not resist. Then the queen became attracted to the diamonds. And then she left the king and went to collect diamonds from the diamond mountain. And then the king was thinking, now I am alone. No one is with me to get the darshan of the Lord. So then he left the queen and went alone to get darshan of the Lord. So he went to that mountain where the Lord has told to give darshan. And then when he went to the mountain, he saw the Lord was standing there. So he paid his obeisances to the Lord. And then the Lord said, oh, my dear king, where are your subjects? You had requested me to give darshan to them. I was not agreeing to do. But you requested again and again, so somehow or other I agreed. I'm waiting since long time. to give darshan to your citizens. So where are they? You have come alone. The king felt very embarrassed. What to speak to the Lord? With shame his head was down. With folded hands, he told to the Lord that, "My dear Lord, these people are not worthy of getting your darshan. I know that's why you did not agree in the beginning, that these people are not worthy to get your darshan. But I insisted, that's why you agreed. But now I realize that how foolish this my citizens were. That you are the source of everything. You are the source of copper, you are the source of silver, you are the source of gold, and you are the source of diamond, everything. Because Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, "Aham sarvasya prabhavo matta sarvam pravartate." I am the source of everything, both material and spiritual. So these people are so foolish. If they would have come and get your darshan, they have got you, who is the source of everything. But now they got some material useless things, which they cannot enjoy anyway. It will not stay with them forever. And they lost the chance of getting your darshan. They lost the chance of getting out of this cycle of birth and death, the eternal suffering of this material world. So this is the attachment and greed which comes from passion. That people, they are away from God. They have no time to think of Krishna. They are always busy to fulfill their material desires, and to fulfill their material desires, they perform so many different kinds of sinful activities and get the resultant reaction, which is misery. They work with miserable condition, and the result they get is misery. And then Krishna says, "Ajnanam tamasah phalam." And those who are in the mode of ignorance, they are in great illusion. Ignorance means no knowledge. They don't know what they are doing, what is good for them, what is bad for them. They don't know. Nidra alasya pramada. This is the symptom of people in the mode of ignorance. They like to sleep more. They are lazy and they are in illusion. Great illusion. That's why these people, they suffer in their life, but they don't realize that they are suffering. We see in material world so many people, they are suffering. But you tell them, "Oh, you are suffering, so you do this thing, then you will be relieved from the suffering." They will say, no, we are happy with this. So they don't consider suffering as suffering, because they are in illusion, in ignorance. And what is their destination? This type of people, they will become animals in the next life. In human form of life, if they are remaining in ignorance, they did not try to go above to the mode of at least passion and goodness, then the next life they will get animal forms. Animals are in mode of ignorance. They are suffering. And those who are in the mode of passion, they will stay here in the midst of human beings, and they will commit different kinds of sinful activities and suffer. So, in this way, these three modes are affecting the human beings and living entities, especially the human beings. And unless we try to come to the platform of at least goodness, we cannot attain pure goodness. Because unless we attain pure goodness, we cannot really perform bhakti. In pure goodness, we can perform pure bhakti. But to come to pure goodness, at least we should be in the platform of goodness. And from there, we should try for pure goodness. That's why it is essential that those who are cultivating Krishna consciousness, they have to realize then in whatever mode they are, whether they are in the mode of ignorance, passion or goodness, or in pure goodness, accordingly they will get the results. If someone is performing devotional service in the mode of ignorance, and he leaves his body in that mode, then his destination, because there is little difference between people, those who are in only in ignorance but not performing devotional service, their destination is different. They'll get animal life. But those who are in ignorance but still they are performing some devotional service, and if they did not improve themselves, go to higher modes, and they leave their body in the mode of ignorance, then their next destination will be Pitruloka. They will go to Pitruloka, which is near Narkaloka, hellish planets. And those who are performing devotional service in the mode of passion, if they don't improve themselves and leave their body in that state, so their destination will be Swargaloka. They will go to heavenly planets. And those who are performing devotional service in the mode of goodness, and if they leave their body in that state, they will go to Brahmaloka. But those who are performing devotional service in the mode of pure goodness, only they can go to spiritual world. That's why it is very important, by hearing the scriptures, by understanding from the scriptures, we can judge ourselves in what mode we are and how can we improve to attain that pure goodness and perform devotional service to Krishna and go back to Krishna. Hare Krishna. Is there any comments, questions?
Stay abroad. I know housing purchased here, there are so many things he is purchasing. And he is alone, he is a brahmachari. But he want to build houses and this one, for what I told him, why don't you come and stay here anymore? Then he said, then bus next year, I mean next year, he almost, he has completed more than 25 years. And he is having 2-3 properties here in Bombay property, in his village properties. So what is the use of when you come into postal, in the beginning you came, you are a pujari there, you are in Bombay being pujari and everything. And now you go out and collect money and you are so much money conscious. So when you leave your body, your attraction is with all the properties you have there. So what destiny you will get there?
So I said already.
So knowingly, this is knowingly, sir. Just like knowingly. They are bringing, they understand, they read Bhagavatam, they listen to Bhagavatam, but still they are in.
They get some self-satisfaction, oh, I have so many properties. I have so many houses. I am such a big man, I have so much property. It's a passion. It's a passion.
So they go to Swarga.
Yes, and then again come back.
But when they understand, when they are hearing the Shastra, Nidhi, Bhagavatam, Seva, Bhagavad Gita, they are listening. But still, if they cannot practice, like so many sannyasis and other people, they see, they have the properties, they have somebody give their gifts, okay, they are giving you gifts, this is for you and this one. So then, our conscience is that, oh, this property somebody has given me, so I have to take care, whether the lighting is there or the painting is done or something is done. So conscious is everybody is in those things. They can knowingly also, how we are so much attached to so many things.
So that's why you have to be very careful that even if we have property or different things, but Srila Rupa Goswami says, Yukta Vairagya. Even if we have our property and different things, but where is our attachment? Attachment to the property, our wealth, our family members, our enjoyment, or Krishna? That makes the difference. That if we are attached to Krishna, even if we have all these things, we are not attached to that, then no problem. But if you are not attached to Krishna and attached to all these things, then we will come back again. That's why we have to be very careful. Only we should be attached to Krishna. Even if we have everything just for performing service to Krishna, but we should not get attached to anything. That's why Rupa Goswami says we have to develop Yukta Vairagya. Yeah, because that develops attachment. When you have so many things, that develops attachment. Unless you are properly Krishna conscious and you are utilizing those things in Krishna service properly, you will become attached to those things. Then the whole purpose will not be solved. You will be again taking birth here. But if we are getting things but utilizing in Krishna service, and thinking it, this is Krishna's, not mine. Because the whole purpose of having different properties, we are thinking this is mine. I and mine. Jivasya mohayam aham mameti. This is moha, illusion. We are thinking, I am the enjoyer and this is mine. But if we think, no, no, this does not belong to me. I got it for Krishna. This should be utilized in Krishna service. I am just a servant. So this ownership is not there with a devotee. And he is only attached to Krishna. Then he can go back to Krishna. But if little attachment, come back here. Yeah.
The Lord has the plan for everyone. That's why Lord said to him, no, I will not give you darshan. Then he insisted, Lord said, okay, I want to show him. Then Lord showed him that how the people are.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
So in a way, Lord is showing us, but still we are so much attached to so many other things.
will become like citizens, we become a dust. And instead of getting Krishna, we go back to our home. That is the problem with us. Hare Krishna.
Oh.
No, for Krishna we are ready to do everything. That is the difference. Because when you serve Krishna, that is in the mode of pure goodness. When we are dedicated for Krishna's service and we do everything for Krishna, even we can utilize our modes in Krishna's service. Then that becomes purified. That mode becomes purified. So when you utilize, because we are utilizing these modes for our service, when you utilize for Krishna's service, then it is purified. Like Hanuman, he went to Lanka, he burnt the whole Lanka for Lord Ramchandra. He was angry at Ravana. He used his passion for Krishna service. He was a great devotee of the Lord. So, how much we are dedicated for Krishna service, accordingly we will employ all our modes, all our wealth, whatever we have in Krishna service. If we are dedicated, we will employ everything. We employ ourselves, we give up our life even for the service of Krishna. That conviction should be there. When a devotee has that type of conviction, then he is not affected by different modes. But when that conviction is not there, I and mine is there, then problem comes. Even sometimes for serving Krishna, if you are thinking, okay, I will do this and I will get the credit, then I comes there. That becomes a problem. So, we have to give up this I and mine. We don't work for profit, adoration and distinction. We only work for the satisfaction of Krishna. Then that becomes pure devotional service. Hare Krishna. Jai Shri Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki, Jai Srila Prabhupada ki, Jai Gaura Bhakta Vrinda ki, Jai.